This has been a month. Wait, what's that I'm getting? It's only a week. Oh, what a week it has been. One of the longest, most news-packed weeks of the year when it comes to U.S. politics. So here are five headlines, and I'm going to talk about them all in just 30 seconds. Number one, Gordon Sondland implicated Mike Pence, Mike Pompeo, and Mick Mulvaney in his testimony. Number two, Laura Cooper testified that Ukrainian officials knew as early as July 25th that there was an issue with U.S. military aid. Number three, Fiona Hill testified that the Kremlin is prepared to strike again at the 2020 presidential election. Number four, David Holmes said that Gordon Sondland was angry and not happy with Rudy Giuliani. And number five, David Hale said what happened to Marie Yovanovitch was wrong. Whew. This week, open testimony, public testimony into the impeachment inquiry of President Trump continued. Many career diplomats testified again, they had done so behind closed doors, before Congress about what they knew and when they knew it about the Ukrainian question. So, who are these diplomats and what are the ramifications they face when we all move on and they're still in their jobs? To help me understand all of this better, I am joined by my friend Rear Admiral John Kirby, a CNN military analyst and a diplomatic analyst. John had a 29-year career in the United States Navy, was Deputy Assistant Secretary of Defense for Media Operations, U.S. Navy's Chief of Information, Pentagon Press Secretary, spokesperson for the U.S. State Department, and most recently, he served as Assistant Secretary of State for Public Affairs, and he was appointed to that role by President Obama. My God, that's a long resume. Is the video over? Okay, no, John is here. Thank you for joining me, Admiral. All right, Admiral, I want to start simple. We have seen a slew of people who are described, you know, whether they're State Department or whatever, described as career diplomats. Just walk us through what comprises a career diplomat. Are these people political appointees? Are they partisan in any meaningful way? But how do you get that distinction?
The Career Foreign Service was founded in 1924, and it is basically the diplomatic version of the military. These are men and women. They join at a very young age, typically. They work at very basic jobs and then work their way forward up through a series of assignments, both under Republican and Democratic administrations. They are not politically aligned. They are not partisan.
They're not appointed to these jobs, for the most part, at the lower level.
They're assigned to these jobs. Exactly right. The way I was assigned as a young naval officer, there was no politics involved in the ships that I was sent to, or even the deployments that I went on. And it's the same way for these diplomats. Now, as they get more senior and they become ambassadors, because there's a fair percentage of our embassies overseas that have career foreign service officers as ambassadors, those are political nominations and they have to be confirmed by the Senate. Just like when I was an admiral, to become an admiral, I had to get confirmed by the Senate. But that is at a very senior level. By and large, these are mid-level career folks just as dedicated in a nonpartisan, apolitical way to serving the country as the military.
Okay, so I get that. First of all, dumb question. Are all ambassadors political appointees everywhere in the world? They're not.
No. There's a great debate, is what percentage ought to be political appointees, in other words, donors
or usually friends. Usually donors. Those are the ones I know.
Right. Or career foreign service. The vast majority of, we have almost 300 embassies around the world. The vast majority are career foreign service officers because you just simply don't have the talent pool to nominate, you know, 300 political appointees.
Who know about the region
exactly,
or the country.
And right. The language requirements and all that. There are a smaller number of embassies that are staffed by politically appointed ambassadors. Somebody like Ambassador Sondland, who was our ambassador to the EU, or Rick Grenell, who's our ambassador to Germany.
Right.
Those are political appointees. It's a smaller number. They typically go to countries where English is at least the primary language or the main language of diplomacy, and they're countries that we have major bilateral relations with.
Okay, so Admiral, I want to talk about this. Once the national media horde moves on from people like Marie Yovanovitch or Lieutenant Colonel Vindman or Bill Taylor, what then? How do they go and sort of report for work on Monday? How weird is it? Is it weird? And is it the kind of thing that you can do successfully?
Yeah, I think that's one of the wonderful things about the career foreign service, and frankly, the active duty military, is they are professionals. This is their profession. This is their job. This is their livelihoods. And so they very much want to get back to that. And I think that they are and they will be. They're eager to get back to anonymity. They're eager to get back to doing the job that they swore an oath to do. Now, is it going to be more difficult for them? I think in some cases it will be, but not necessarily the popularity or the fame that they might have gotten temporarily from this. While that's uncomfortable for many of them, I don't think that's what's going to make it difficult. I think what's going to make it difficult for some of them is the manner in which they have been maligned by the president's supporters and by the president himself. That's a difficult thing. Even if you do go back to do your job and you can do your job 100% with the same capability you did it before, you're still, that's going to stick with you. That's going to be a psychological scar you're going to bear for a long time. And I felt for the colonel when I watched him testify, because I know how hard that had to have been for him to publicly come out and criticize the activity, the behavior, the conduct of the commander-in-chief, who is in his chain of command, at the top of that chain of command. That's a difficult thing to do. And I think it speaks to a sense of moral courage and duty that he had. And he talked about duty several times in his testimony. And I think, and I can't get inside his head, obviously I don't know him personally, but my guess is that's what it boiled down to him. He didn't want to be there. I don't think he was relishing it, but he felt like he had to do it. In fact, there is a logical argument that can be made, and I know this may sound crazy to some people, that he would have been derelict in his duty. He would have been violating his oath to the Constitution, to the American people, if he hadn't spoken up in the moment and to his chain of command at the White House, and I really believed he felt it was his duty to do that.
Fascinating. Thank you. Thanks, Admiral.
My pleasure.
Yes, sir.
Great to be with you, Chris.
Yep. What's my big takeaway from that? Well, I didn't know, honestly, that all ambassadors weren't political appointees, although now that I think about it, it makes sense. And I think the biggest other thing is that most of the people who work in the diplomatic corps aren't partisan. They're not political. They didn't get their job at being appointed. They were assigned a role, not appointed to one. We make new Point episodes every Tuesday, Thursday, and we make a special impeachment dedicated episode every weekend, like this one. See something you like, don't like, got a question, want to see us take on a specific part of the impeachment inquiry you don't get? Put it in the comments section.